Do you need any help with that?
No, it's fine.
All right. Everything all right with your room?
Yeah, thank you.
Wait, what? How many people live in that flat?
Functionals are everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coughing does the bidding bridge, your sentinels for fun and for the prize, cause sentinels are with us all the time.
It's getting a bit crowded, right?
Yeah.
Lately, since all of these guys have been moving in.
We're starting to have some bottlenecks in the kitchen, bathroom, so.
Yeah. Maybe I should move in with my partner.
Hmm? Partner? Girlfriend? What's her name?
Boyfriend?
We've been together since 3 years.
How did you manage that we never met him?
I'm pretty sure you met already.
Uh-huh.
Will you give us a name?
Jonas.
Yeah?
So this branch predictor thing, you said something about breaking KSLR with that.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Yeah, so the branch predictor, it takes some bits of the virtual address, scrambles it and whatever, and targets the branch target buffer with that.
Mm-hmm.
So now say we have a branch in a kernel at a randomized address, and we also have a user space program with some branches. And if these virtual address bits collide, they influence each other. The branch in the kernel and in the user space.
And then you get mispredictions in the kernel.
Mm-hmm.
Because the user space mistrained it.
Yeah.
Huh.
Or the other way around. So I can see where this randomized branch lies.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we can do something more powerful with that. Maybe some more powerful attacks.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, attacks on crypto. I just found something here.
Mm-hmm.
Already exists something. Predicting secret keys via branch prediction. By Archimedes and colleagues, or CPU side channels versus virtualization malware.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that Manuel has a partner?
Yeah.
Can you tell us his name?
Why don't you ask Manuel?
He won't tell us.
And probably I shouldn't tell you either.
But you know the name.
Yes.
Hello.
Hey.
Can we...
Get the key for the seminar room. Here you are.
Thanks. How did you...
You always want to have a key. You're so predictable.
Thanks.
You're welcome. See ya.
You think we could exploit that on Daniel to leak a name?
So we could ask him specific names.
And then?
When it's the correct name, his reaction will be different, right?
So you just have to... probe all the names.
Yeah. You see.
Just like a million, right?
Yeah. But I think I have an idea for that. Hey.
Huh?
What are you working on?
Oh, I'm just drafting some text for my thesis.
Manuel's partner's name.
Mm-hmm.
It starts with an S, right?
No.
M?
Mm.
A?
No.
B?
No.
C?
Look, I won't tell you what it starts with.
It starts with an C.
No, I didn't say that.
But you leaked it.
Wait, could you bring computers to leak secrets like that?
You mean via... branch prediction?
Sort of, yeah, with speculative execution, but not like we side-channel the BTP, but instead we make the victim program behave in unintended ways.
Mm-hmm.
How would that work?
Speculative execution. Well, waiting for branch decisions sometimes takes a long time, right? Because maybe it needs to fetch something from memory or something. And the branch predictor will then store what happened the last time, maybe the last few times it has seen this branch.
Yeah, we discussed it already. So we should get to the point, right?
So basically you prime the branch predictor and then
some other process that has a branch on a congruent address will see mispredictions.
But how is that dangerous? It's all a speculative execution.
Yeah.
Fully reverted, right?
Yeah, yeah. That's right. But there's side channels.
Like?
The cache, for instance.
So you want to use a cache side channel here?
Yeah, yeah. You could, during speculation, you could just access some memory location and it would be loaded into the cache.
Nice idea.
And after speculation, you check which location is cached.
Mm-hmm.
But you forgot one thing. The victim has to do that.
So we need misspeculation in the victim. Where would that occur?
Everywhere, basically. I mean, you have branches everywhere, and any branch can misspeculate.
Yeah, but are there exploitable branches in a typical victim program?
You mean any program? Any program can be a victim.
Yeah.
So you manipulate this branch predictor so that it mispredicts a bounce check.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be the idea, right? And then the victim can access some out-of-bounds data and load it into a register.
And then what does it do with this value in the register?
Maybe it would use this value from the register then to access another array with this value as an index.
Yes, if a code pattern like this occurs, the value read out of bounds is directly encoded into the cache.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's a good idea. Let me try that out. It works. Here, look at this. I have exactly this array construction here, and I can see the secret.
But that is just Spectre PhD exploiting the pattern history table for direct conditional branches. But there's more. There's Spectre BTP, where you exploit the branch target buffer. So you can literally inject an address there, and the victim jumps there.
This is really a big problem. Think about it. Branches like this one, they are used everywhere. Bounce checks, they are considered best practice and used for that reason everywhere. This is a huge problem.
I think we should contact the vendor about this.
Yeah, yeah. But maybe let's also check which other branch predictors can be used for this.
Well, I mean, I guess all of them. And why only branches? Imagine if the CPU speculates on data or data movement, you can exploit that as well.
Yeah. So we have the PHT, we have the BTB.
And then they basically build up the whole tree from our trans execution text paper.
PHT, BTB, the RSB, the return stack buffer is missing.
It would be a good idea to use these here to sort out our ideas. Oh, so the PHT and BTB and the RSB.
Ah, I read about the RSB. I think in my CPU it's a simple ring buffer, only 32 entries deep. So if you have really deep nested function calls, you get like overflows in the ring buffer and mispredictions.
There's also something called straight line speculation.
What's that?
Well, essentially, it's just the most stupid branch predictor. You remember? We discussed it some weeks ago. It just always predicts the next instruction, even across some control flow changing instructions.
Okay, but that's probably just a special case of the regular branch predictors, like the PHT, BTB, things like that, when they don't have any prediction, I guess.
Andrea suggested data movement. Mm-hmm. What about store-to-load forwarding?
Yeah, let's add store-to-load forwarding.
You can also distinguish between same process or cross process. Think about a sandbox where an application running inside the sandbox attacks the sandbox itself.
But is cross process the right thing here then? Is it more like cross address space or cross domain maybe? So we have basically two potential subvariants each then.
But then you should also take into account how the mistraining is done. whether it is on the exact same address or a congruent one.
And with that, they are at the full tree. Next, they would check and verify which of them actually work.
But is it really a complete and exhaustive list, a tree?
I think not. If there are more elements or predictors that we don't know of yet, they would be missing.
There's some pattern in your codes. And in all cases, you have some kind of preparation or preface where you create a situation where the victim mispredicts.
Yeah.
Your code there, it makes some assumptions.
These assumptions are pretty generic, like, yeah, there is a branch predictor, or the branch predictor is shared.
No, much stronger assumptions. You basically expect the victim to run a small piece of code that can be attacked. A small piece of code with a branch or whatever instruction you need to run speculative execution.
Yeah, but that's not my code.
But why would the victim have exactly this piece of code in there? For example, here you have a memory access with a secret you have read.
Uh-huh. It doesn't have to be exactly this pattern. It could be any code pattern, any dependent memory access that encodes it into the cache.
That's right. But you still need some code pattern in the victim. It reminds me of ROP.
ROP?
Return-oriented programming.
Yeah.
You assume you can override the stack, but nothing else.
Yeah?
You can override the return address and jump wherever you like.
Ooh, that sounds powerful.
Not yet. So you can run to really short ROP gadgets that do something useful that you need and then return at the end.
Yeah. And you basically, you stitch those ROP gadgets together and then you run a few instructions and then return to the next.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And then you run basically arbitrary operations by running one short ROP gadget after the other.
Oh, and so you mean we also have these kinds of speculative execution gadgets in the victim, and we could use those?
Yes. And if you don't have a gadget, you can't attack the victim.
Right, yeah. But can't I inject a gadget into the victim?
Maybe in some just-in-time compiled cases?
The kernel nowadays has a just-in-time compiler for eBPF.
Daniel, do the viewers know what eBPF is?
They don't need the details here. We'll just say it's some kind of scripting language
that gets just-in-time compiled in the kernel.
Yeah, makes sense.
No, it does not. Why would anyone do that?
There's a bunch of use cases for it. You can use it for profiling, monitoring, and so on.
But the user could do harmful stuff with it, right?
We could use eBPFs to inject gadgets into the kernel.
That's amazing. I think I could implement that.
I'll first write an email to Intel, because if that works, they better get started on that early.
Yeah. It works.
Yeah.
I can leak all memory of this, of the kernel. Probably all memory there is in the system. This is really huge.
Was? I got the response from Intel here.
Wow, they wrote back so quickly.
Wait, is that realistic?
It totally depends. So in some cases we had vendors replying within hours. In other cases it took weeks or even months. Or sometimes never. You never know.
I mean, the situation was worse a couple of years ago. It's gotten better now that the vendors realized how important its security is.
So one thing they are writing is this blog post by Jan Horn. And I checked out this blog post and he reverse engineered the branch predictor. So he checked how he can mistrain it and then what influenced it. Has on other processes, on other security domains. And he also had this eBPF trick in there.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's an entire team of researchers that discovered it. They wrote a paper about that. Maybe you can open it. It's called Spectre Attacks.
Exploiting speculative execution.
Yeah, this one. Spectre was quite big and covered by mainstream media together with Meltdown.
But wait, Meltdown is not on the list for this episode.
All just known stuff again. And it's already, already discovered.
What about mitigations against it?
Already exists. They wrote all of that here. That mitigations exist.
Oh.
They released microcode updates. Yeah.
Can you show me the tree?
Oh, sure.
So for Spectre STL, there are microcode updates against that. They work by, instead of predicting, just stalling. And for RSB, Spectre RSB, there was a fallback to the BTB, the branch target buffer. And again, microcode updates disable that.
What about BTB and BHD?
There are different mitigations for that. By Intel, for instance, microcode updates to introduce three mechanisms. The first is STIBP, single thread indirect branch prediction. And what it basically does is it restricts the sharing of the branch predictor across hyperthreads. So they don't share this state anymore. Then IBPB, the indirect branch predictor barrier, which is sort of a flush operation for the BTB. And then after the flush operation, you don't have the branch predictions in there anymore. And IBRS, indirect branch restricted speculation, which restricts branch mistraining to its own or lower security domains. So you can't mistrain the kernel from user space anymore.
Really?
Yeah.
I doubt it.
Why?
In my proof of concept, I do in-place mistraining. The mistraining happens in the kernel. There's no user space involved. So I'm not sure this is all mitigated.
Yeah. There's also another approach for the BTB, which is software-based. It's called Redpoline.
Redpoline?
Yeah.
Sounds like the name of an attack.
Redpoline is very simple. It says, well, let's not use the BTB at all. Let's instead write the address that we want to jump to, that we want to call the function address, onto the stack and misuse the return instruction for the indirect jump.
That's super ugly. But also elegant in a way. Also, can't I exploit the RSB instead then?
Just fill the RSB with nonsense addresses or with addresses that you know can't be used for an attack. RSB stuffing.
And what about PHT?
Oh, that's the worst one. The thing is, Spectre PHT, with Spectre PHT, you usually do the mistraining in place. And, well, out of place is possible, but if you have the bounce check example, for instance, that's not necessary. Just mistrain in place by providing inbound values first and then out of bound values.
Wait, so there is no defense?
There are. There, for instance, one that uses fences everywhere, and suddenly you get them all in your code, ideally with a compiler extension. Yeah? Or you just restrict it to the secret dependent branches.
But L fences are slow. And how do you know what are the secret dependent branches?
There's another option. Make all operations within a branch depend on the branch condition arithmetically. So their result cannot be computed during speculation unless the condition has also been resolved. And that is basically what we call speculative load hardening. There are a few different variations of this, but they all make the operations within the branch depend on the same condition.
And what about the performance impact? It will be substantial, right, of all of these three?
Yeah. Especially for in-place variants, it appears that if you want to get rid of them, we would need to get rid of useful speculation as well. Yeah, and that's not good.
No.
Guys, I found something more here. A blog post on the topic by Anders Fogg.
Oh, interesting.